Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the 42nd WEDC conference. I know you've already been welcomed in the different sessions. My name is Dennis Mwanza, and I work for Research Triangle Institute as a senior WASH advisor. And welcome to this session, which is basically looking at modeling and monitoring. While I'll be chairing this session, I'm actually working very closely with Professor Sohail, who will be monitoring the presentations, particularly the chat side. So before I go far, I would like to actually encourage all the participants to please put in your questions in the chat section. All the questions that you have, please put them there, either clarifications or a comment, but please put your, I'd encourage you to put your questions or whatever you have in the chat box. And at the end of the first presentation, I'll ask a prof to basically guide us what questions we may have. Well, I think today this is a very interesting topic, which sometimes may not see it so much and so on, but it's on modeling and monitoring, two important aspects in any program or project implementation. We have three presentations, one from Benjamin Harris, who is going to discuss with us on the progress towards SD6 and the state of country-led WASH monitoring in East and Southern Africa. And then the second one is from Barbara Ward, who's going to talk about Sludge Snap, a machine learning approach to fecal sludge characterization in the field. A very interesting topic. And lastly, but not least, from Madalitso Mng'ombe, who's talk about modeling of Kauma waste stabilization pond treatment process using artificial intelligence. So we're really looking forward to an exciting moment as we listen to the three presentations. And as I mentioned, we will be getting questions and then, ask them at the end. Now, I'm not seeing the video.
Dennis, can you hear me, Dennis, now? Okay.
Okay. So, Benjamin Harris, yeah. So that's the first video, so I'm going to play the video, and then I hope, Benjamin, you've already given us your information.
Hello, everyone, and thanks for joining us.
Here's the presentation.
My name is Ben Harris. I'm an independent WASH consultant focusing on WASH monitoring and evaluation. Presenting alongside me today is Kumbazila Zuma, who is a WASH specialist with UNICEF Eastern and Southern Africa Regional Office. Today, we'll be presenting results of recent exercise to map and understand routine monitoring systems for WASH in all countries across Eastern and Southern Africa region. I will start presentation with an overview of why we undertook the review, the methodology we followed, and our headline results. Kumbazila will conclude with a focus on the consequences of what we found for the WASH sector in the region and more widely. This assessment of monitoring systems was part of the SDG 6+5 review, a broad multi-stakeholder review of progress towards SDG 6, supported by UNICEF Eastern and Southern Africa Regional Office. 2020 marked 5 years since the adoption of the SDGs and the specific goal for water and sanitation. This represents a moment for the WASH sector to take stock of progress towards SDG 6, understand the gaps in our current knowledge on levels of access, and take action to ensure that SDG 6 is met in the 10 years left to 2030. In addition to this assessment, UNICEF has also commissioned a report on the state of financing for WASH in Eastern and Southern Africa and engaged in extensive stakeholder consultation. The process will help support and position member states to advocate for WASH and resource allocation to WASH as part of the SDG midterm review. The starting point for this assessment is that data is essential to meeting SDG 6. Achieving SDG 6 requires increased investment in WASH, but securing increased investment requires robust data to demonstrate the need to financing partners, but also to ensure that that investment is targeted where it is needed most. So we looked for government-led national monitoring systems, which provide WASH data on a frequent, at least annual, basis. This included systems from water and sanitation ministries and utilities, but also education and health monitoring systems where this collected WASH data. This mostly comprised management information systems, but we also looked at some representative surveys, which are undertaken on an annual basis. We didn't focus on data sources already included in the JMP estimates. So we collected information on monitoring systems in two ways: extensive review of existing documentation and data sets, and also key informant interviews with government officials responsible for WASH monitoring, facilitated and supported by WASH specialists in UNICEF country offices. Our assessment looked at three areas: the availability of routine monitoring data for WASH and how well it's aligned with JMP service levels, the strength of the enabling environment for WASH, measured against a series of building blocks, and details on how the WASH monitoring systems were structured and managed. On to our findings. We looked at JMP estimates and routine monitoring data to understand whether countries are on track to achieve SDG 6. This will be a surprise to nobody here. We found that no country in Eastern and Southern Africa is on track to achieve SDG 6 or to achieve universal access to basic services by 2030. In fact, only Botswana is on track to achieve universal access to basic water. Nothing else is on track. The data behind this is from 2020, but most recent JMP estimates using more recent data from July 21 tell an almost identical story. We looked into the actual data collected in routine monitoring systems, going into detail to understand if the underlying data was sufficient to report against key indicators. What we found is that there are a large number of countries where routine monitoring systems are still focused solely on technology type, and systems are not capturing the data needed to report against JMP basic service levels. In only a very small number of countries, are systems starting to collect data on some, but not all, of the elements needed to report against safely managed service levels. We also found that in some examples, there was still confusion over exactly what information was needed to report against the SDG 6 targets. We looked at whether countries had set national targets for SDG 6 and how they were able to monitor progress against targets. All countries had set some national targets, taking into account what is appropriate and achievable in their context. But in the majority of cases, either there was no data available to report against the targets, or the data available did not align with the targets. For example, progress is reported against targets for safely managed services, but no water quality data is available. This misalignment may give countries a misleading picture of progress against SDG 6. And no country collects routine data which allows it to fully monitor progress towards all the targets it has set.
So we also looked at the availability of data. We started looking at water and taking the JMP reporting system and comparing it with the routine monitoring systems. What we found was that in terms of the extent of monitoring, no country has monitoring data for access to water service that is aligned fully with the JMP indicators for safely managed services, for instance. But also, in addition to that, we found that the limiting factor was the absence of routine monitoring data that's focusing on water quality. We also found gaps in terms of looking at sanitation data availability, in that we noticed that of the 12 countries with routine monitoring systems for sanitation, only five were able to report, but to the limited service level. And we also noticed that in terms of collection of information to allow the fecal sludge management, this is a challenge. And there was no country that was collecting data to look at all the three aspects of SMM that are included in the JMP indicator. So we also looked at hygiene. We noticed that a total of 12 countries have no routine monitoring that is focusing on hygiene. And however, where data is available, these are generally aligned very strongly with the GMP indicators. And this we noticed in 7 countries collecting monitoring data, which aligned with the GMP indicator for basic safeties. What the study also showed was that good quality monitoring systems need a strong enabling environment. We saw that with all the countries with good data availability that they have strong enabling environment, for instance. We chose 3 countries, South Africa, Zambia, and Zimbabwe. And if you look at the right, you can see that the monitoring systems are fairly strong for all the 3 countries. But when you look at left as well, you can see that the enabling environments are really good for all the 3 countries. That is one area. But when we move further, we looked at we found that actually this strong enabling environment doesn't necessarily lead to good data availability. This we saw in Ethiopia, where you could tell, looking at the right, that the monitoring systems are not so strong, even though the enabling environment is really strong. But when we also moved to fragile environments where the context and the events that are happening in that country aren't allowing the process to work to the favor of the people and the users in the country, you can see that the enabling environment is not so good. But on the right, the monitoring systems are very strong. And this is as a result of external partners that are providing the support in the country. Main highlights from the analysis. We presented that data is locked away and not available to stakeholders. We also indicated that there needs to be increased in the human capacity, including training of the people so they're able to collect data adequately and appropriately. We also noticed that some countries are already using data from utilities, and therefore this is an area where there could be improvement and other countries learning from countries that are already using this system. We also indicated that there is no single answer as to how to collect data, but that we need to mix various systems and data collection methods as appropriate to meet all the data needs. But we also, what is very critical is to notice that when designing the systems around user needs, this results in the most successful systems. But what does it mean for the WASH sector? It means SDG 6 progress requires increased investment in WASH, and this should be targeted in the right places. But with lack of data, it becomes more difficult to demonstrate gaps and to identify exactly where the investment is needed. However, without addressing data gaps, it's also difficult to advocate for investments because priority might be elsewhere instead of prioritizing WASH. Also, it's very critical that data should always be aligned to GMP periodic surveys and indicators. Next steps for the SDG 6 plus 5 are to continue with stakeholder engagement, which is through meetings, workshops that we have with our donors and key partners at regional and national level, but also within UNICEF country offices. The next actions are to implement the recommendations from the analysis, including conducting deep dives at country level. But we also presenting findings to donors so they can identify which areas they want to fund. Another thing is to continue with our knowledge sharing across regions as well as countries.
Right, so I have some questions, Dennis, if you allow. Can I?
Yes, please go ahead. Yeah.
Okay. So Benbala has asked two questions. One is, who is going to respond? Is it Ben? Is he? I'll try to put him on picture if I can. Right. Okay, the first question is, SDG is broad and has bunch of targets. Since this was a rapid assessment, did you focus on specific targets? If so, which particular indicator did you use to a certain country specific progress towards SDG? Is Ben Harris? Okay, if you can
unmute,
speak, Ben.
He's typing. I don't know. He says he can't use the video, but I was hoping that he can use at least audio.
Yeah. Okay, so I can read what Ben Harris has written. Good questions. I can start responding now. We focused on 6.1 and 6.2. We did initially look at some other aspects around IWRM, but this didn't form part of our overall finding. Okay. Ben, can you use audio?
No, it's just typed that audio isn't working either.
All right.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead then, Ben. You can respond question number two.
For the rest of the participants, if you've got any other question, please don't forget to type it in the chat box.
Okay, so Linda is saying, yeah. Has that improved, Ben? Okay. Dennis, how are we doing on time? Because I think we have another.
I think we can move. We can move to the next presentation. So thank you so much. Ben is saying it's still not working. But whatever the case, I think if you can type in any additional responses that you have, Ben. So the
I'm
next.
Sorry, I think it's working now. Can you hear me?
Okay, great. Yeah, great.
Sorry, I'm not sure what happened there. I can turn it on quickly. So I'll just respond to Ben Bella's second question quickly so you can move on with the
next
rest. So we spent a lot of time looking at localization of the SDG6 targets. So trying to understand whether or not countries had set appropriate targets, which reflected their level of ambition and the local context. What we found was that although most countries had set local targets, for SG6, and the language of these targets usually reflected JMP indicators. When you start digging into the local targets, it's not very well defined what they're actually measuring. No, so it will be expressed in terms of, for example, safely managed water, but there's no explanation of what that actually means. And we can tell they don't have the data on water quality or whether water is available on premises to actually report that. So what you see is this disconnect between the language countries are using to report their progress and the data that they actually have, which we think means typically countries are over-reporting their progress towards SG6. I don't think in terms of striking a balance between sort of the WHO and UNICEF standards and country-specific standards, I don't see that as a contradiction. I think
you can maintain the same indicators, but the level of ambition can differ. So every country can decide whether it wants to achieve access towards basic, limited, or safely managed services. But aligning with the JMP indicators, which in the vast majority of cases are appropriate to local context, allows us to make better comparisons between countries. Hopefully that answers your question, Bambela. I can't say any more, so I'll just turn my audio off now.
Okay. Thank you so much, Ben. And I think it's a very interesting topic, and especially when we're talking about the SDGs, and we only have like 9 years before we reach the the end, and none of the countries is on track, which is interesting. So the next presentation is from Barbara Ward, Sludge Snap. It's a very interesting one. A machine learning approach to fecal sludge characterization in the field. So now we're going to listen to her video, and then and then we can ask questions. Please, again, don't forget to type in your questions.
My name is BJ Ward, and I'm a PhD student at AVOG. I will be presenting today, along with three recent graduates of Virginia Commonwealth University, to tell you about Sludge Snap, our machine learning approach to field characterization of fecal sludge. Dr. Linda Strande, who leads the research group Management of Excreta, Wastewater, and Sludge at AVOG, will be answering your questions at the conclusion of our presentation. So first, I would like to explain our motivation behind this project. As those of you who have previously worked with fecal sludge probably know, fecal sludge characteristics can be highly variable. You can see that in this histogram of influence COD measurements from Lubiji treatment plant in Kampala. As you can see, influent fecal sludge characteristics can be up to two orders of magnitude more variable than influent wastewater, and they also follow a completely different distribution. This high variability presents a unique challenge in operating and monitoring treatment technologies, and also in estimating quantities and qualities of fecal sludge for sanitation planning in cities. Characterization of treatment-relevant metrics such as total solids, COD, ammonia, dewatering performance is currently really difficult to achieve in many places that rely on on-site sanitation, because access to analytical laboratories can be prohibitively expensive, or it's simply just not available. In situations like this, it would be very helpful to be able to supplement laboratory analysis with cheap, fast approximations of important sludge characteristics. In practice, to supplement laboratory analysis, practitioners and operators and researchers already use their expert knowledge to predict sludge characteristics and adjust operations accordingly. For example, this could include using sludge color as a predictor of level of stabilization, or whether the sludge comes from a pit latrine or a septic tank as a predictor of total solids or other characteristics. In this case study example from a pilot plant operated by Sanivation in Kenya, which we will come back to several times throughout this talk, polymer flocculant dose is adjusted based on whether the sludge coming from the arriving truck was collected from a pit latrine or a septic tank. So the question is, how do we quantify and improve these field predictors of fecal sludge characteristics to make them more widely useful and accessible? And that was the focus of our recent publication, where we tested a number of possible field predictors based on practitioner experiences. For example, taking a picture of the sludge and using the color and texture from the picture as a predictor of its characteristics, or using probe measurements like conductivity and pH. We used these field predictors and quantified their power to predict treatment-relevant analytical parameters using machine learning models. We built these models based on a dataset of 465 samples collected from 420 different locations in Lusaka, Zambia. We characterized both laboratory analytical parameters and also performed field measurements. So for example, here at the bottom, you see us taking a picture of the sludge as a field measurement of color and texture. Results of this study were quite promising. We found that machine learning models offered a substantial improvement compared with current estimates of practitioners. Coming back to our example of predicting total solids for flocculant dosing at Sanivation, using a pit latrine or septic tank to predict total solids gave us a model with pretty low accuracy with an R-squared of around 0.2. Contrasting that with a random forest model based on photographs of the sludge, specifically on color and texture data extracted from photographs, we were able to produce a much higher accuracy prediction with an R-squared of 0.6. And we found that in general, machine learning models based on photos and probe measurements worked quite well to predict not only total solids, but also ammonium and dewatering performance in the sludge from this dataset. As we continue our research, in the future, we can refine these predictions and practitioners can use them to improve the efficiency of their operation. And that's where the Sludge Snap app comes in. This app aims to package our models and image processing so that they can be easily used by researchers and operators in the field for rapid prediction of fecal sludge characteristics. Here, you see a picture of someone using our app. Next, three recent graduates from VCU will explain how they developed the Sludge Snap app based on our research.
First, we color correct the photograph sludge. We use the color chart present in the left half of the images to correct the photo. After that, we need to identify the location of each petri dish. Using Python-based image recognition libraries, we can find the circular border of each dish and isolate the pixels that make up each sample. Knowing this, we can extract color and texture information about each sample. This data becomes part of the input that the machine learning model uses to make its prediction.
We split the machine learning portion of the app into two parts, model training and model testing. For the training, we use the data provided for us to reflect real sample results from the field. So we reformatted that data, then used a random forest model in the scikit-learn library to create the trained models for each individual target variables. During the testing, it would take the inputs from the image processing portion along with other inputs and compare them to the trained models. Afterwards, the app will output some predicted values for each target variable.
Hi, and welcome to our demo of Sludge Snap. We wrote this application as a mobile-first web app, but I will be demoing it in a desktop browser for ease of recording. This is our homepage. As you can see, there are two options available. You can either upload your data without saving the resulting analysis to our database, or you can log in order to save your analyzed data. I will be demonstrating the logged in upload flow, as the anonymous upload is virtually the same. As you can see, we are using Auth0 for our authentication, which allows you to sign in using existing accounts such as Google. Upon logging in, you are immediately prompted to upload your data for analysis, which we will do now. On mobile, you will be prompted to either upload an existing photo from your phone or to take a new one. I will be entering data from a sample taken from a household pit latrine in Lusaka, Zambia. The image and other provided information are now being processed by our image recognition and machine learning models, which will provide predicted sludge characteristics based on the inputs. And there we have it, field-ready predictions for use by treatment plant operators and researchers.
The proof of concept Sludge Snap app that you just saw demonstrated and the models behind it are promising, but they are based on 420 containments in one city. In order to move forward, we need to collect data in new cities and use it to build a global database of sludge characteristics. Based on that data, we can understand what models are globally or locally applicable and better quantify prediction uncertainties when the models are used in new cities. We also plan to streamline the data processing in the app to make it simpler and faster for users in the field. As we incorporate these improvements, the goal is that in the future, practitioners all over the world will be able to use Sludge Snap to supplement lab analysis in their cities. If you have questions about Sludge Snap or our machine learning model, please feel free to ask Dr. Strande during the question and answer portion of this session, or get in touch with us by email.
Thank you so much for this great presentation. Please, Prof, you can take over now. Prof, do you have any questions? Have you? I can't hear you, Prof, if you're speaking.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can. Yeah.
Okay, so Linda was responding to some of the questions, so let me pick which was not picked up. So there's a comment from Buzili. It is very true the JMP standard is very ambitious, hence we also consider what monitoring system. I'm not sure where the question is. So you can't hear me?
No, we can hear you, please, Prof. Continue.
Okay. So I think most of the questions were responded to in the chat by Linda. So if I've missed any. Okay, so there was something about sampling which was responded. So I'm not going to read again, but if there's a new question, please put it there. Okay, so let me put a question, Linda, that, you know, this is the first time that in WEDC conference, we have tried to put this theme of data analytics and AI related to wash sector. So I'm really pleased to see some of the presentations here. So what do you think is an added value you have established for the use of AI so far? I'm not sure what's happening with our.
Yeah. Linda, are you back? I think we may need to bring Linda into the. Okay, she's back. Okay. Now we can't hear you, Linda, if you're speaking. Oh,
sorry about that.
I see. She's not on mute.
Yeah. Linda, can you hear me? Okay. So what I asked was what added value of AI you think was established.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Excellent. Okay, so sorry, the first question I heard you ask was about that this is the first time this is presented, so what is the added value?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. I think there's many added values. I think one, the laboratory analysis is quite expensive, but something like AI and modeling can be quite inexpensive and can be available for anybody because there's many free resources available on the website. So we've actually also been sharing all of our raw data and have shared over 1,000 data points of fecal sludge samples in Asia and Africa in the last couple of years. And now this information is available for anybody that wants to use it in ways like this. And it could also give us less expensive field methods, and the level of accuracy that's necessary will depend on the application. So for example, if we're talking about citywide planning, we need less accuracy than, for example, if we were talking about monitoring or adjusting operation of a treatment plant.
Thank you, Linda. Just last question probably, or I can add in. So are you thinking of having or creating some sort of like data repository where people could just put the data there?
Exactly. So that's our plan. We're currently searching for funding so that we could do that, make a global database where everybody could take pictures in their city. And then we can make the app so it continues the machine learning app and continues to refine the analysis based on the additional information that people upload. And then we can evaluate, can one model be used everywhere or do we need to develop different models for different regional areas?
Great stuff. I wish I could have £1 million to give you.
Okay. Great. I think this has been great. We need to move to the next presentation, if that's okay. Unless there's an additional question. Is there another question?
No, I can't see any additional one which has
not. Okay, I'll just look in the chat and answer anything else.
Okay, that'll be great. Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Okay, so the next, which is our last presentation this afternoon, is from Madalitso, which is on modeling of Kauma waste stabilization pond treatment process using artificial intelligence. So I'm going to do just as usual to play the video, and then we can, as you listen to the video presentation, please raise any questions you have on the chat. Thank you so much.
Welcome all. My name is Madalitso Mng'ombe from Zuzu University, Malawi. I'm making a presentation on the modeling the performance of Kauma sewage treatment plant using artificial neural networks and posology. I will take you through this presentation outline, background up to the references. Starting with the background, wastewater treatment process aims to achieve a treated effluent and sludge quality that is environmental safe for disposal or reuse. In developing countries like Malawi, waste stabilization ponds are commonly used, and mainly waste stabilization ponds are designed to remove organic load, which is normally measured as biochemical oxygen demand. As you can see from the figure 1, wastewater treatment operations are affected by two major problems, namely stringent environmental standards as well as left increasing pollutant loads. These two problems can be addressed by either constructing new wastewater treatment facility or by improving existing plant operations. The first approach is costly, as capital expenditure is required for constructing new wastewater treatment facility is very high, and required land might not be available due to planning and environmental cost structures. Time scale involved is also such that this option is not feasible in short to medium term. Hence the second approach, that if it can be properly done, it can help to improve effluent water quality, reduce the need of chemicals, and save energy and operation costs. Now, what's the current status regarding wastewater treatment facility in Malawi? Taking you through the chart from the bottom, there has been increase in wastewater generation due to urbanization, population growth, as well as industrialization in Malawi. And this led to establishment of stringent environmental regulation to ensure that water bodies are protected by reducing point source pollution. Despite existence of the regulatory framework in Malawi, there is a limited and non-existent effluent treatment. In addition, there is a lack of comprehensive and regular monitoring of wastewater treatment plants and surface water quality by disposable authorities due to limited staff, inadequate funding, as well as inadequate laboratory facilities. To address this problem, is through the mathematical modeling. So the mathematical modeling are important for improving wastewater treatment efficiency, and that's the quality of effluent that are released to the water body. The models can also help the operator to predict the performance of the plant in order to take cost-effective and timely remedial action that would ensure consistent treatment efficiency and meeting discharge costs. The problem statement. The operations of Kauma sewage treatment plant only depend on conventional experimental approach to determine the quality of treated effluent water quality before discharge or reuse. However, this method is time-consuming. For instance, it requires 5 days to measure BOD, and their determination procedure involves the use of dangerous chemicals such as sulfuric acid. Objective: to address the challenge hinted in the previous slide, this study aims to model the performance of Kauma using artificial neural network and fuzzle logic. Specifically, the study aims to predict missing values and replace outliers from historic water quality data for Kauma. And also the study aims to use Cohen soft organizing map as software sensor for predicting BOD. And the study also aims to develop integrated and supervised artificial neural network model through the use of Cohen soft organizing feature extracted data. And also the study aims to model the fuzzy inference system for predicting BOD5. Significance of the study: the models to be developed will result into improvement of effluent water quality for Kauma, which is the main target of SDG 6.3. Study area: the study will be conducted at Kauma, which is located in Lilongwe, the capital city of Malawi. The plant was constructed in 1996 with a design capacity of 6,100 cubic meters per day, and 5% out of this population are connected to sewer system, and the remainder rely on on-site sanitation. And effluent for Kauma are discharged into Lilongwe River, which is the main river within the city. So looking at the figure 2, this is a map of Malawi, and this is a map which is showing the capital city of Malawi, which is Lilongwe. Within capital city, we have Kauma sewage treatment plant, as you can see from the diagram. So these are the ponds. The effluent from these ponds are discharged into this river, which is Lilongwe River. Research design and sampling: the study will adopt experimental quantitative research design, and minimum sample size will be an 96 data set for each water quality data as used by Kodadadi et al. And sampling location will be at the entry point before screen and septage lagoon, as well as discharge location. Both primary data and secondary data will be used. Primary data will be collected for 6 weeks on a daily basis, and all parameters will be determined according to Alpha 2017. Modeling approaches: so the models will be developed in 4 main stages, namely data processing, choosing algorithm in MATLAB programming language, as well as selection of model structure, and performing numeric analysis. So in the first stage, the descriptive statistics will be generated. This will be in the form of minimum value, maximum value, mean standard deviation, as well as correlation matrix for all the variables. And outliers will be identified through box and whisker plot, and all missing values will be replaced by a 9, which is not a number to meet the MATLAB requirement. In stage number 2, we'll be choosing algorithm in MATLAB programming language. So this algorithm will be chosen in line with the specific objective that has been hinted in the previous slide. For example, the specific objective number 1 and 2 will use this algorithm to achieve those specific objectives, that's predicting missing value and outlier, and also use this algorithm as software sensor for predicting BOD5. Integrated artificial neural network, that is a supervised and unsupervised artificial neural network, it will be developed through the use of these two algorithms: Cohen soft organizing map, which is an unsupervised algorithm, and MATLAIR perceptron artificial neural network algorithm, which is a supervised algorithm. So these two algorithms will be used to develop integrated model. And the last algorithm is that of artificial neural network fuzzy inference system. So this is a combination of artificial neural network as well as fuzzy logic. So these two algorithms will be combined to develop software sensor for predicting BOD5. The third stage is model structure selection. Here, the model input variable will be selected based on their correlation to BOD5. So the correlation matrix that have been developed in the first stage will be used to identify the input variable that have highest correlation to the BOD5. So the last stage will be that of numerical analysis. So the numerical analysis will involve training, testing, model evaluation, as well as hypothesis testing. So model evaluation, we use these indices to evaluate the models: correlation coefficient, mean square error, average absolute error. So these will be used to evaluate the models. And paired t-test will be used to test whether there is a significant difference between objective value and simulated results in MATLAB programming language. So this is a preliminary results which are showing the descriptive statistics for the primary data that has been already collected for Kauma. So the primary data is covering about 4 years, in 2008, 2014, 2017 and 2019. So the primary data, it is having the highest variables are having about 167 data set, which is pH, as well as total suspended solids. So as you can see, this column is showing the number of missing value. We have missing value within the data set array, and there's also number of outliers have been noticed within the data set array. So this need to be replaced using coherent self-organizing map. So this is a box whisker plot that has been used to identify the outliers. And this is a correlation matrix that has been used. This correlation matrix, much we are interested with the variable that have a correlation to the BOD5. So as you can see, most of the variables have moderate negative correlation to the BOD5. Other variables have positive correlation to the BOD5. So this is a raw data. Once it will be processed, the correlation matrix will be plotted again to show which variables have greatest correlation to BOD5. Those variables that will have greatest correlation, it will be chosen as model input variables. So this is just a graph which was just showing the correlation coefficient of variables. So this is a discussion based on the previous table that has already been done. So that's the references, and that's the end of presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Madalitso, for this very clear and comprehensive presentation on the use of artificial intelligence in the stabilization pond treatment process. I will hand over to Prof to guide us on any questions and discussions on this particular interesting topic.
Thank you. So we have a question from Ben Bella. Were you using modeling approaches and techniques in tandem? Now, if I could add my question to that, you know, you mentioned about supervised and unsupervised algorithms. So also mention about whether you are going, you are using in sort of like concurrently, or you use one, and then what was the reason for that? I think probably Ben Bella has a similar question.
Thank you for your questions. I don't know if I'm clear. You able to hear me?
Yes.
Oh, all right. Thank you. Mainly, the study, in the study, what I'm intending to do is to combine those approaches in order to improve the predictability. So in the first place, the modeling process will be done in stages. Like, I think in the third objective, where I'm combining the artificial coherent self-organizing map and the multilayer perceptron. In the first place, we'll predict the BOD5, and then we'll add another algorithm after coming up with the module, and then we'll add another algorithm in order to improve the predictability of the BOD5. So I'm intending to use these techniques concurrently, the modeling approach as well as the techniques, just to improve the predictability of BOD5.
Okay, thank you. So while we are waiting for some more questions, if there are any, could you just reflect on that in terms of the future use of these techniques? You know, how do you see, you know, how long before people will be using these techniques as a daily routine? Are you thinking of like less than 5 years, even less than that, or 10 years? What is your prediction?
Since the artificial intelligence techniques, they have ability that when the new data is coming up, they'll be able to update itself. So we can develop this model for maybe for 5 years, but as the data is coming into the models, it will be able to update itself, making the lifespan of the feasibility to be longer.
Okay.
Yeah, so the sustainability depends on that. As the data is being found, the predictability will be increasing. The time of predictability is expected to be increasing.
Okay.
Okay, great.
I think somebody's typing, so we'll see what the question is. In the meantime, you think the lack of available data is going to be a problem for application of AI?
Come again?
Do you think that we have enough data to start using artificial intelligence?
Yeah, for the case of Kauma, I think I've obtained the quite number of data that I think it will be enough. Currently, I've received about 200 and something variables. So I think it's still giving the good basis for the for this task.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think I can see Corbina and Ben Harris are typing. So let's just see, you know, what the question is, and then you could kindly
all
respond.
Right.
So I don't know.
If you listened to the presentation, the previous presentation by Barbara and Linda, is there anything you can get from there in terms of fecal sludge characterization?
And the use of
artificial intelligence. Yeah, please go on.
Yeah, quietly, I'm very interested with the previous presentation, particularly when she's applying the AI to the fecal sludge. It's just something that I've appreciated, that I've learned something. I never expected that we can apply this even in the characterization of a fecal sludge. So it's much interesting study, and I'm looking forward to read more on that paper.
Yeah, she has just typed that you can collaborate. Yeah.
All right, thank you. Yeah. That is welcome idea. In fact, I have a primary data for a fecal sludge. I think that might also be very important to her study.
Okay.
So we have something from.
So where I was collecting this data, they also provided me with the fecal sludge data. So I think it might be very important to the previous study.
Oh, that's good. Sure.
As they have said that they were looking for how they can evaluate their models. I can be able to. I'm very happy that we can lead a work together on that one.
Okay, that's great. Yeah, Prof. Next question.
So I'm not sure whether there's a question in it, but Ben has some comments. I think more broadly, the WASH sector really suffers from a lack of data, in bracket, for example, access and functionality, and that which is collected is quite unreliable. In specific circumstances with tightly controlled data, AI and ML can be great, but we need to be careful about wider applications. Okay, and then Kwabina said most LDCs have not started out basics of WASH delivery and are way behind on SDG targets. Can we not focus more on delivering a basic rather than jump into application tools such as AI? So I think that is not direct question on the presentation, a bit more of a, I think, you know, you can respond, but I think, you know, AI is about trying to do that thing to give more access and more quickly, probably. Anyway, over to you.
So do you have any comment, Madalitso, about this issue of the SDGs and then the AI, that we might be jumping the gun too fast?
Currently, I don't have much to say. I'm expecting to get interested in this study. I've not yet completed the work, so I'm expecting very interesting results at the end of this study, and I'm expecting to develop a very useful model that will help to evaluate the challenge of wastewater monitoring in Malawi, which is currently a huge challenge. So I'm expecting a lot from this AI. Really, it is going to solve much a problem that we are currently facing.
Yeah.
All right, and we have a comment from Linda. We should start now, but be realistic, transparent, and honest. Report exactly what we can and cannot do. Then we can build up from there.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Okay, so Professor, thank you so much for being a great partner as we have been co-chaired or co-facilitated this this session. I think to me it's been great. It's quite revealing, starting with the presentation from Ben Harris on the SDGs and how countries in East and Southern Africa. And to me, it actually reflects for most of sub-Saharan Africa that most of the countries are not on track. In fact, according to your statements, none of the countries in Southern Africa, I would still be surprised that even South Africa is not on track, but none of them is on track to, you know, to meet the SDGs, and yet we're remaining with only 9 years. And the presentation from Barbara also was quite eye-opening on, you know, fecal sludge characterization, and the last one also from Madalitso. So I think to me, all these three presentations have been great. Thank you so much to the presenters. You've really brought in quite a lot of interest, and I'm sure further debates. So we certainly will be closing the session shortly, but I think it's something to help us continue thinking and reflecting on how we can help governments. The issue of data is very, very important, as mentioned. And now we keep talking about decision-making based on data. In England, it's very interesting how the Prime Minister kept saying that all our decisions are going to be based on data when discussing issues of COVID-19. And in all areas, really, of our life, data is key, and we have to see how we can promote having quality and reliable data, which can be used to make appropriate decisions in anything that we are doing. So thank you so much to everyone, and the session is now closed at this particular moment. Thank you so much, and
thank you.
Bye to everyone.
Thank you.